Welcome back. So, today we are going to show you two very special projects we completed a few years ago. These are highly detailed Chernobyl models our team built completely by hand, with no 3D printing. And there is a chance you could see them if you ever visited the Chernobyl nuclear power plant on tour. The first one is a highly detailed model of the entire power plant site. Here are all reactor units, the turbine hall, auxiliary buildings, various connections, and much more. Of course, including the new safe confinement and the sarcophagus of Unit 4, which you can see in very detail. This model gives a good visual explanation of how big the power plant site actually is. But as you have probably already noticed, strangely all the buildings here stand on some sort of glass. That's because the model has one secret, which we will learn about very soon. So, how did it start? Well, those who visited the power plant, say, a decade ago may remember that they actually had this large model originating from the mid-80s. It was created before the disaster, so there you could see stage 3 with units 5 and 6, as well as cooling towers, as if they were completed. However, after the Chernobyl disaster, that expansion was cancelled and that part of power plant simply stays unfinished. The model was a little bit changed, a sarcophagus was added over Unit 4, and this way it served for years. But over time, new facilities appeared at the power plant site, and with the new safe confinement rising, this old model largely became more and more irrelevant. And so, one day, the power plant management asked us to make a new version, but not a usual one. And fast forward, this is what it looked like in operation. It had to have realistic buildings placed on a transparent panel. That panel had to be positioned on a large plasma television embedded in a table. And this way it could show different technological processes, or say, computer networks, or railways, or logistics, literally anything. However, we gave one more suggestion, so the power plant visually is not in a good shape, but at the same time, that's its signature mark. All this rust, all these sealed windows, concrete and glass blocks, this reflects the challenges this facility went through. And we believe you agree with us, not showing that would be really a shame. And so we started. Well, we decided to make it completely manually, from paper, and then hand-painted. You may ask a question, well, 3D printing was already available, why not to use it? To our mind, after all, whom you can surprise with something made on a 3D printer, right? And using known proportions, a large archive of pictures, and of course Google Maps, we started making buildings one by one. For example, this is a solid radioactive waste processing facility, exactly one of those new buildings. It has quite a complex shape, so we decided to use thin but dense cardboard. Once positioned, cardboard parts were soaked with cyanoacrylate, basically super glue. This was a cool technique because it allowed us to join parts edge to edge and effectively turn them into something like plastic that could be later be sanded flat. And so, like this, we made boxes of most of structures. Then we painted the roofs with black matte modeling paint, and after that we added one more layer of cardboard painted to reflect wall textures. And finally we added small elements such as pipes, doors, ladders or antennas, and despite being only a few inches in size, well, it looks pretty good. Here is, for example, a scaled, similar facility for liquid waste, built in the same fashion. But some facilities have distinct marks. For instance, this is a diesel generator station for units 3 and 4. These large exhausts of the diesels of Unit 4 have not been used for nearly 40 years, so in reality they very much rusted. And so, to reflect this, we added this detail to the model. We also made the characteristic shape of the roof, stairs and vents. But some buildings have even more details. For example, this reserve heating plant, where we added custom piping made of bent polystyrene. Or this auxiliary systems building, with its chemical tanks and various interconnections to other structures. But still, that was the easiest part. The real challenge came with units 3 and 4, which required quite a bit of imagination. That's because not only the geometry of this part is really complex, it also had to match the new safe confinement installed on top. And so for this part we made the walls in large sections with added details. One of such details was the distinct panels the plant is actually built of. In the photos taken from a distance they are not really visible, but in reality they are there. So we imitated them with grooves made using a box cutter. Then came the real challenge of making the new safe confinement, or arch. Since structures inside it had to remain visible, we decided to make only one arch segment and a part of the insulation, along with the eastern and western walls. Everything inside was painted, and the inner part of the insulation was metallized, just like in the real arch. But here it also played a functional role. It reflects the light from the TV screen below, illuminating parts of the sarcophagus inside. And once everything was ready, we arranged all the buildings on a table. And to our surprise, we could even recreate the famous photo you can find on one of the power plant's brochures. Then we shipped everything to the power plant, where it was equipped with the underlying display and programmed by the IT department. They also added few more small details. Initially, the model was installed in the administrative building, and it was there on exhibit until 2022. Unfortunately, in the February of that year, it was pretty badly damaged. And so, once the power plant was liberated, the model was moved to Slavutich, the satellite city of the power plant. There it underwent a repair, and now it is on display in a new museum that recently opened in the main office of the nuclear power plant. That was our first major model for Chernobyl. But a year after, we were asked to tackle something even harder. That was the model of the spent nuclear fuel storage facility number 2. What is really special about this project, that a major part of it we made using long tweezers. That's because actually we had to modify an existing and completely outdated model that was largely impossible to disassemble. But to make more understandable what exactly we did, let's first look at what this facility actually is. ISF2 consists of two parts. One is the installation for processing the fuel rods. There are a few detailed videos on the official channel of the Chernobyl Nuclear Power Plant about how this all works. You can find a link in the description below. But the core idea is simple. So a special railway car brings a sealed container with a certain number of fuel rods. This container tilts and connects to the hot chamber above. Its walls are extremely thick, because inside materials are highly radioactive. And so inside there are manipulators and cameras and all kind of instruments that allow operators to do various kind of things with those rods. The most important here, they are remotely cut in half, because each rod is 9 meters or around 27 feet, which is not very convenient for manipulations. Then these two parts are placed in their individual storage pistons and positioned in a container. This container is then filled with helium and then hermetically sealed. Then the container is moved using a special machine into the second part, the actual storage. These are large concrete compartments, where they are positioned horizontally and covered with a special lid. But this is not a burial. At any moment the storage can be opened for inspection. There is also circulation of air around those sealed containers, moisture removal and so on. However, that is the revised project which was eventually implemented. The initial one, created in the 1990s by one French company, was slightly different. They built the structures, but then it appeared that some things were not really suitable, and so it was suspended. Years after, the new contractor had to do the very complex job of fitting new technology into those existing buildings. Because don't forget, inside are very massive walls, which are very hard to change. Ironically, somewhat a similar problem came with the model, which by then was completely forgotten. So, that model was also built by that French contractor, and it had very few details. But the biggest issue was it was made of painted plexiglass, and I guess anyone here who had ever glued plexiglass knows it's like welding, it's basically once and forever. And the only one option to change it is basically to break it. And so, just to get access, that's exactly what we're forced to do in some places. Eventually, after some trial and error, the best strategy we chose was to make large decorated fragments and then place them inside using those long tweezers. In some areas, like the main hot chamber, it was relatively easy. The challenge was just getting dimensions. This is one of its walls, and this is what it looks like completely assembled. I believe you noticed that actually here is a big selection of various junk we used for making the tails, from screws and wires to even Soviet transistors imitating cable connections in the walls, or for example straws for soft drinks we used for making manipulators. But some places were much harder. See those windows? So, from the other side of the wall, they look like this. This is so-called operator's bridge. In original model, here was literally nothing except the actual platform. So, we made a complete assembly and then we had one single attempt to place it. Well, I believe it looks really good. But that was nothing compared to this place below, because here is a long two-level corridor where the train arrives. This pre-assembled wall is at the very far side, and you can imagine how remarkable was to position it. Then, once all this was done, we started adding details. For example, the heavy sliding doors of the hot chamber and the decontamination water sink next to it. Notice, it has even a tap. Or a transporter for a container of solid radioactive waste. Inside this container go, for example, spent cutting discs and dust collected from the main hot chamber. The real building is covered with shiny thermal insulation. That was quite a complex task to find the proper material, so eventually to imitate it we used metallized paper. We also added rainwater drains, antennas, gates and various doors. But especially interesting was making these complex cable channels. All that is a painted cardboard. Well, honestly, it took a lot of time, but I completely loved making that part. Well, it may sound surprising, but in reality, none of this was as complex as making all those red ladders and fences. There are dozens of them here, and each must look identical. And so all of them are made with multi-layered cardboard, chemically secured, and then painted. And just to give you a perspective, in this ladder alone, there are more than 300 precise parts. Well, I must say that this project took quite a time to complete, but once the model was ready, it was also exhibited at the power plant along with the first one. Unfortunately, in 2022 it also got some damage, which led to parts falling apart, but as far as we know now, it was all corrected. Today both models are on display in Slavutich, in the new Zona Art Museum in the headquarters of the Chernobyl Nuclear Power Plant. If you ever come here, you can see them in person. And perhaps, like us, you will realize how sometimes the smallest details can tell the biggest stories. Speaking of which, if you are new to our channel, check out our other episodes, because we have many, many Chernobyl stories and projects you might like. And for those who want much more, join us on our Patreon page, which is in a large archive of our unique insights and research content. The link is in the description below. And we will see you in the next one.